I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Stanton Forbes' bizarre retrospective tale of entanglement. If two of them are dead. Starring Earl Howard, Catherine Burns, and Nina Foch as Sister Love. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Quaker State Motor Oil and Contact. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
The 30s of the Depression. Three people sit in the parlor of a lonely Midwestern farmhouse. Joe John Plunkett, 24 hours off a passing freight train. Dorcas Kimball, whose father, Joe John, has just helped to bury in the cyclone cellar. And Sister Magdalene Love, the beautiful evangelist, who has come to Joe John and Dorcas with a strange proposition. If two of them are dead, continues after this word.
I've been riding freights most of my grown life, although I wasn't really that old. And I had my share of close scrapes and run-ins. It got to be where I could sense when something bad was going to happen to me. So all I could figure out was I must have taken a pretty fair blow to the head when I jumped off that last freight. Because if I'd had any sense at all, I'd have been long gone from here by now. I mean, first, getting took in by a cripple kid who talks me into escorting to some holy roller shindig. Then getting half-tricked into burying her father, who she killed. And then sitting in the parlor drinking tea with her and a lunatic lady evangelist who had just about the craziest notion I'd ever heard of in all my life.
I want you to kidnap me. Kidnap you? I'll pay the two of you $1,000 to keep me here in this house for 2 weeks. Here in my house? It's perfect. No one would suspect that Sister Love was being held a prisoner in such an ordinary, nondescript place as this.
You're nuts. Yeah, I always figured anybody in the line of work you're in had to be.
You are both responding just as I anticipated you would. It is only out of your initial surprise at the idea. Neither of you are shocked. I counted on that. Well, if you want to know the truth, Joe John Plunkett, you owe me this.
Oh, yeah. Well, all of a sudden, it seems like I owe everybody something.
That little scene with that drunk last night? For your information, that had been carefully planned and was being beautifully executed until you interfered.
Well, that figures. I should have known better.
The man you struck was Clay Turner. He come to me a poor sinner, bereft of his family, his job, everything, because of demon rum. We prayed together several times. I drove the devil from his soul. He was very grateful.
The perfect pigeon, huh? A poor sinner you were going to make into a rich sinner.
What I'm planning to do will harm no one. And it will enable me to help thousands of poor souls that otherwise I might never reach.
But how kidnapping you do that?
By bringing greater fame to the name of Sister Love. So that I may carry the word throughout the length and breadth of this land. From New York to California.
Really?
And if you and Joe John do as I say, you'll both be able to travel wherever you wish.
Yeah, well, I already do.
I mean in style.
Yeah, what about this Clay Turner?
You took care of him. And I had Brother Love give him $100 for his trouble.
Yeah, Brother Love. Now, what does he think about this mad scheme of yours?
Oh, Brother Love does whatever I say. For instance, at the moment he's waiting outside in that hot, hot car. Although I've no doubt he's enjoying a peaceful afternoon nap. He's my Uncle Micah, you know, An obliging, harmless old man.
Is it true what he says in the pamphlet? Did you predict that your Ma and Pa were going to be killed the way they were?
I did. Although I'll confess to you, it was a safe enough prediction. Bessie and Abner Love, my mother and father, carried the gospel message over the most dangerous kind of mountain terrain. And they never spent a nickel on repairs for that old bus of theirs. Poor noble souls.
They sound as crazy as you do.
There's nothing crazy about what I'm proposing. I have it all worked out. We leave for Chanute tonight right after the service. You would follow me there in a car.
Yeah, well, now there's a snag right there. What car?
Never mind about that right now. I'd slip out in the middle of the night and meet you, and then we'd return here.
As simple as that?
Mm-hmm. I'd leave the ransom note and arrange the scene before I left.
Very neat.
Then, in about 2 weeks, I think it should be, you'd be free of me and $1,000 richer.
But how are you going to get rescued?
Oh, or are you just rescue yourself? And if you're kidnapped, now there's supposed to be ransom money. What about that?
Well, the ransom should be sizable. $50,000 sounds right, don't you think? Well, the amount doesn't matter because it'll never be paid. No, the ransom note will state that instructions will follow, but they won't. The three of us will just sit here and wait until the 2 weeks are up.
Yeah, that sounds cozy.
Then you and Dorcas here can do whatever you wish. I'll tell the authorities the kidnappers got frightened and ran away. And, of course, my description of my abductors will be constructed purely out of my imagination.
We'd hope.
What about the car we need? Where are we going to get it?
Well, Joe John would have to buy a car under his name. You could keep it to go away in, Joe John. Now, just think how free you would be with your own car.
Mm-hmm. Well, listen to me. Hopping freight suits me just fine. And now that I've heard this whole scheme of yours, I think you're crazier than I even thought at first. And listen, Dorcas Kimball, if you got any sense at all, you'll get this mad woman out of your house right now.
Don't you worry, Sister Love. I'll talk to him. You'd be surprised at the things I can get Joe John Plunkett to do.
There's nothing on this earth that surprises me, my child. And as for my worrying, remember, I have faith.
All I knew was this was a chance for me to get away, to really go to those places I've been dreaming about all my life. Great Aunt Nadine's money plus my half of $1,000 make me good as rich.
But you're as crazy as she is. Hell, I'd be spending 2 weeks with two cuckoos in a cuckoo nest.
For $500 and a new car?
Yeah, well, it wouldn't be worth it. No, if I did decide to go along with it, it wouldn't be for the money.
Well, what would it be for, then?
Because it would be something to do. A gamble. With the stakes against me. You wouldn't understand.
Well, you don't understand me either. But that doesn't matter, as long as we both have our reasons.
Yeah, she was right there. We were a couple of misfits, Dorcas Kimball and me. Sister Love knew what she was doing. She couldn't have chosen two more likely sinners to do her dirty work. We both had nothing to lose.
Ah, you've decided then. You're going to do it.
Well, that depends. I mean, I don't like that part at the end where we drive off into the sunset and you tell your little fairy tale.
Joe John's got a better idea.
Yeah, your uncle's going to have to face the police and the newspapers with the ransom note, you know?
Oh, there's no problem. I'll simply tell him to be very upset about it, but to say or pay nothing.
No. You just, you tell him to pay it. That is, to pretend to pay it. He can leave a dummy package, which we'll pick up, and then we'll set you free. That makes a lot more sense.
Yeah, it will make more publicity for the newspapers. I agree. Anything else?
Yeah. A letter from you stating that this whole thing was your idea. And we'll also have the dummy package as evidence. So it's just a couple of little security measures.
All right. But there's no reason why you shouldn't trust me.
No, there's no reason why we should.
It was excitement. just like in the movies. We had to postpone the plan for a few days, till Joe John bought the car. Then I addressed a letter to Sister Love, care of General Delivery in Chanute. The letter was in code to let her know we were ready, and all it said was, Jesus saves.
About time you came. I wasn't enjoying waiting out here in the middle of nowhere at this hour of night.
You wouldn't have liked me to get a speeding ticket on the way, would you?
How you like your new car?
It serves the purpose. Did you leave the ransom note?
Of course. $50,000 or Sister Love will be sent to heaven. Newspapers will like that. I can hardly wait to see the headlines tomorrow.
Neither can Dorcas. She thinks this whole thing is a game.
Yeah, poor child. Probably starved for a little excitement in her life. This is a strange child. How old is she?
17.
Seems younger than that to me. It's odd, a young girl like that living all alone in that house. Until you came, of course. Both of her parents are dead, I gather.
That's right.
Are you related to her on her mother's side or her father's?
What?
I heard you tell the deputy you were cousins. First cousins.
Yeah, that's right. On her mother's side.
What about your folks? They still living?
My old man fell off an oil rig. Killed himself instantly.
Oh, it's terrible. What about your mother?
What is this, some kind of third degree?
I was only being friendly. After all, we're going to be living together for 2 whole weeks. We may as well get to know each other.
Yeah, well, you know enough already.
Only that your father's dead. And that you come from a better background than you try to make out.
What makes you think that?
Well, it's one of my stocks in trade. Finding out about people from what they say and the way they say it. I've worked hard to get rid of that Tennessee twang I used to have. You can't have an accent in my business. People, they have too many prejudices.
Yeah, well, I know about people. You don't have to tell me about them. Look, I travel in my business too, you know?
Yeah, being a failure, a bum.
That's right.
If your mother is still living, what does she think about
it? I didn't say she was still living. Look, I didn't say anything about it at all.
Oh, forgive me, Joe John. I didn't know your mother was a subject you didn't wish to discuss.
Well, you just asked too many questions, that's all.
That's another of my stocks in trade. But it's late. I'm too tired for any more talk. I think I'll go lie back and try to sleep the rest of the way.
Yeah, well, that'll be just fine with me.
She sure likes her rest, don't you?
The longer she stays up in her room, the better I like it.
Well, she probably doesn't want to be seen in those house dresses she had me buy. They're real plain, no ruffles and ribbons.
You know, I got a feeling she'll still look okay.
Yeah, I suppose so. With that face and that hair, and the way she walks.
Her stock's in trade.
Huh?
Nothing. Anyway, she'll be down soon. She's going to want to see this newspaper.
Well, that must be her coming now. Oh, hush, Tiffy. Tiffy won't stop barking at her.
Dogs are smart.
Did it come yet? The newspaper. Is it here?
It's here.
Am I in it?
You're in it.
On the front page.
Really? But where? I don't see it.
Down at the bottom.
Yeah, I guess they thought MacArthur and those bonus marches in Washington were more important.
Michael Love, here in Chanute with an evangelist group holding revival services in a tent on Route 39, told Sheriff Edward Billings that his niece, Sister Magdalene Love, had disappeared from her room in the Chanute Hotel Wednesday night, and that a kidnap note had been found. Sheriff Billings declined to comment on the note, other than to say that bloodstains on the paper might indicate foul play. The sheriff's office is investigating the disappearance of Sister Love. Is that all there is?
That's all.
Well, it doesn't tell anything about me. They didn't even use my picture. I left a lot of pictures with Uncle Mike.
Yeah, well, look, never mind about all that. Now, what's this business about bloodstains on the ransom note?
Oh, I just thought that would be a good touch. I put my finger to do it.
Well, I don't like it.
Well, why should you mind? It was my finger, my blood.
You're just setting us up for a shooting gallery.
I was just
making it a better story, that's all. Oh, shut up, you little beast. Can't you do something about that dog?
Now, Tippy doesn't mean any harm. He just isn't used to you yet. I'll put him outside. Now, come on, Tippy. Now, that's a good boy. You just play outside for a while. It can't be. It just can't. I couldn't believe it. But it was her, all right. Mrs. Pollyford from down the road. She hadn't come near our place for a year or more. What was she coming now for? Well, there was no time to warn Sister Love. All I could do was try and bluff it out, like I'd done with the deputy about JoJo.
Dorcas, girl, how are you?
How are you, Mrs. Fuddleford?
I'm sweltering in this heat, I can tell you.
Yes, it's very warm, isn't it?
Oh, warm is hardly the word. I
didn't know you had company, Dorcas.
Well, that's all right, Mrs. Fuddleford. You come on in. This is my cousin, Mary Kimball from Seattle, Washington.
How'd you do, Miss Kimball?
How'd you do?
Sorry to bother you, Dorcas, but I need to borrow a cup of sugar.
Well, of course. I'll get it for you right away.
No hurry. No hurry, dear. It's too hot to hurry. Right, Mrs. Kimball?
Yeah. Perhaps Mrs. Puddleford would like a glass of lemonade, Dorcas.
That would hit the spot, all right.
I'll get you a glass.
Oh, thank you, Dorcas. Mighty neighborly of you. I'm sorry it's been so long since I've had a chance to call on you. I noticed your pa's gotten himself a new car.
Well, that's Joe John's car. He's my cousin. My other cousin, he's from out of state, too. We're having a kind of family reunion.
Well, now, that's nice. I always think it's nice when a family can keep in touch. In these hard times, so many families are being split up. Some have to go to look for work one place and some another, and like as not, nobody finds any place. Of course, most folks just don't have the money to go flitting all over the country. Oh, goodness. Dorcas, that's not your pa liquored up again, is it?
Well, that's only Joe John, my other cousin I just told you about. Joe John, this here is Mrs. Tumbleford. From down the road?
Oh. Hello, Mrs. Puddleford.
I explained how we're having kind of a family reunion. You and Cousin Mary and me.
Nice to meet you, Mr. Kimball.
Plunkett. My name's Plunkett.
Here's your cup of sugar.
Oh, yes. Suppose I should be getting back. Imagine you all have family business to discuss.
Yes, in fact, we do.
You've been here a few days longer than Miss Kimball, haven't you, Mr. Plunkett?
Yeah, that's right.
My place being right on the road where it is, I can't help notice some people coming and going. Must say, I didn't see when you arrived, though, Miss Kimball.
I came by train, and Joe John drove in to pick me up. We didn't get here to the house until quite late at night.
Oh, I see.
By the way, Mrs. Puddleford, did you happen to take in that revival meeting they had across the way a few days ago?
Oh, no. My church doesn't hold with those offshoot religions.
Well, the reason I mentioned it is I just read in the paper that that lady evangelist who ran it got herself kidnapped.
You don't say. Why, that sounds like that other one out there in California. Claimed she was kidnapped a few years back. Said some men held her prisoner in Mexico or some such place. But there were a lot of people who thought that was a put-up job just for publicity.
Well, it's not a fact. Well, I guess it's like they say, everything's been done before, right, Cousin Mary?
I wouldn't know.
Well, nice meeting you all. Thanks for the sugar, Dorcas.
You're welcome, Mrs. Puddleford.
You fool! Why did you purposely throw the newspaper story in her face like that?
So that big grand plot of yours wasn't so original with you after all, was it?
I don't know anything about that other case. All I'm concerned about is what if that busybody recognize me. It would ruin everything.
Oh, come on. Now, Sister Love sitting at Dorcas Kimball's kitchen table in a plain cotton dress sipping lemonade. The Lord's handmaiden herself.
I'm going upstairs for some peace and quiet. It's true. No one would ever imagine Sister Love in a place like this.
I don't understand, Jojo. Why did you bring up that newspaper story and everything to Mrs. Puddleford?
Well, I knew it would make any difference. I mean, either she knew or she didn't. Mostly, I just wanted to get Sister Love's mind off all that about your paw.
My pa?
Yeah. When I was bringing Sister Love here in the car, I told her your pa was dead. I just hope she doesn't remember that.
What did you talk to her about pa for? You didn't have to tell her anything about that.
I just said he was dead, that's all. I didn't tell her anything about your killing him or us burying him.
No, Joe John. You didn't.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, If Two of Them Are Dead. I'm Rod Serling. Secrets, like promises, are sometimes hard to keep. Dorcas Kimball had one, but let it get away. Joe John Plunkett learned of one, though he tried not to hear. And Sister Magdalene Love needed one. A body furtively buried in the cyclone cellar of an old farmhouse. A deadly secret now shared by three people. Time now for the test of the old adage. Three may keep a secret if two of them are dead. Our story continues in a moment.
I didn't know who to be angry with. My pa for being the way he was. Joe Jones for talking to Freddie about it. Or Sister Love for listening in on other people's business. Sometimes there's no one to blame but yourself. Anyway, Sister Love knew all about what had happened and didn't waste any time using it to her advantage.
So innocent little Dorcas here is a murderer, and you, Joe John, are an accomplice after the fact, as they say. No wonder the two of you weren't shocked by my harmless little kidnap plot.
Where's all that love and forgiveness you preach when you got that fancy purple robe on?
Dorcas will have to work out her own atonement for her sins, and you for yours, Joe John Plunkett.
And what about the Snow White Sister Love?
I am still as I always was when my dear mother and father were beside me. I sleep the sleep of the good little girl.
I thought I told you to keep that dog outside.
You can't stay outside all the time. Hi, Skippy.
This is Dorcas's house, and that's her dog. Now, it seems to me you don't have the right to order either one of them around.
I'm paying all the expenses, aren't I? That gives me every right. And we have work to do, so get that mongrel out of here.
It's all right, Jojo. Take Tippy back outside now. Come on, Tippy. Come on.
I'm not at all happy with the way things are going so far.
You mean because you're not hitting the front page headlines? That's not our fault.
At least your picture was in today's paper.
On page 5. Oh, you were right, Joe John. We should send a letter of instructions about the ransom. Tonight.
All right. Go ahead and write this. Dear Uncle Micah, I'm being forced to write this note. More ransom money at once to Clay Turner.
Clay Turner? The man who was drunk at your meeting that night.
That's as good a name as any, isn't it? Now, just keep writing. To Clay Turner, General Delivery, Wichita, Kansas. And mark, please forward on outside of package.
What's that for?
Tomorrow morning early, I'm going to go down and fill out a card to forward any mail for Clay Turner to General Delivery, Chicago. I mean, that ought to send him in a wild goose chase. I decided it'd be too dangerous for us to try to pick up that package. I mean, it's certainly going to be a dummy for a newspaper anyway. So, look, go ahead. Write, if all goes well, I will be released
and receipt of the money. But I don't know where. We have to keep them guessing about where we are.
Is that all you want me to write?
No, finish it off with, please do as they say, Uncle Micah. They haven't harmed me. And sign it. Now, the thing is where to mail it from.
Oh, surprise, you don't have that all worked out, too.
I got it worked out. It's only about 50 miles or so to the Oklahoma border. Late tonight, I'll drive over there and just mail it from there somewhere.
I have to admit, that sounds like a good idea.
Can I ride with you, Joe? I've never been Oklahoma.
No, I'm only going to be driving as far as the first mailbox I come to, so...
You'll still be Oklahoma.
No, Dorcas, I'd rather go by myself. I don't have much chance to be alone since I've been here. That wasn't exactly true. Ran out of my cot in the workshop. I was alone every night. Long enough to remember everything I wanted to forget. And then finally to fall asleep and dream the whole thing back to life again. I was a boy again, coming home from school. Coming home to the house I knew the best, a pretty little white house with rose bushes. As I came up the walk, I looked up and saw the open window with the white curtain blowing out of it, my mother's room. I walked up the steps across the porch, let the screen door bang behind me, tossed my school books on the table, and I called out, Mom! I'm home! Mom! She wasn't there, I figured. Gone to the store or something, so I headed for my room. I was thinking about the things I'd just gotten for my birthday, a kite and a new baseball bat, and a toy train. The door to my mother's room was closed, but I heard a sound. I leaned under the bedroom curtain. It's blown in and knocked something over, I thought. So I opened the door, and the whole world went crazy. The room was full of strange, strict people, gesturing wild and all talking in words and angry words that I couldn't understand. Then silence, and then the voices again. And somehow I stood in the middle of all of it with my baseball bat in my hand. It was shining and moving. There was blood all over. And I just stood there wondering, how did I get blood all over my new baseball bat? Tonight, I was pretty glad I had to make that long drive across the border and back. Maybe I was better going to bed trying to sleep, find myself back in that same nightmare I'd lived with for years. But I couldn't take Dorcas with me, even though she was still begging me to when I left.
Why can't I go with you, Joe John?
Well, because I think one of us ought to stay and keep an eye on Sister Love.
Why? What's she going to do?
Well, I don't know. But I just keep having this feeling she's up to something.
But yeah. I know I'm saying with you because I thought you came out of day too. But I'm kind of scared here, Joe John.
Well, there's nothing to be scared of. Yeah.
I still don't have a feeling that Joe John's my friend. Only friend I had besides Tippy. Well, before I went in and gave Tippy the dish of hamburger scraps I had cooling for him on the sideboard, I'd go into the workshop, see if there was anything I could do to make Joe John's cot more comfortable. I hadn't meant to pry. Not really. But when I was sending the sheets and blankets, Joe John bundled out on the floor from somewhere behind the bed, and something fell out of it. A razor and old leather case. I started to stuff it back, and that's when I saw the letters. From Mrs. Henry Plunkett. And then I remembered that talk between Joe John and Sister Love about Joe John's mother. He'd gotten so mad, and I didn't know why. Sister Love seemed to know more about Joe John than I did, and he was my friend, not hers. So I just read one of the letters. My dearest son, thank you for at least letting me know from time to time where you are. I must assume that means you want me to continue writing to you whenever I feel able. I have my good days, of course, bad ones, too, that are better forgotten. But people are good to me here, although it is like prison. Wherever you are, I hope there are people who are good to you, better to you than your own mother, whose sin, justified as I thought it to be, drove you to the dark violence of that terrible day we both can never forget. Always I write to you over and over the same plea, forgive. Forgive yourself, my poor boy, and if you ever can, your mother. Church, I'm going to like you and me. Now, I have to tell you about my pa. Did it really happen? JoJo, hurry up and come back. JoJo.
What's the matter? What are you doing up? Is something happened?
Oh, no, this isn't okay.
Where's Sister Love?
Well, she went to bed a long time ago. I have to talk to you, JoJo.
Dorcas is late.
I got afraid maybe you weren't coming back at all.
Yeah, well, I came back. What's the matter with Tip?
What's the matter, dear? Listen, JoJo, about Pa. I want you to know exactly how it happened, so maybe you won't feel so bad about your part of it.
Never mind that. That's over and done with.
After Ma went away and died, Pa took after me sometimes. When he was too liquored up to know what he was doing, I mean. I guess he was crazy with loneliness and all, you know.
Mm-hmm. Dorcas, how old are you? The truth.
Well, I want to tell you about that, too. I lied to you. I'm not 17. I was just 15 my last birthday.
Well, go on about your father.
Well, like I said...
No, I don't mean about that part. How did you kill him? Did you hit him or something, or what'd you do?
I pushed him. With all the strength I could. And he fell. He fell real hard against the bricks. And then he sort of sunk to the ground. I knelt down to him, and I shook him, and I yelled at him, and he didn't answer me, and then I saw he wasn't breathing anymore. There wasn't even any blood, no blood at all.
You pushed him. You just... That's all you did?
Well, it was enough, wasn't it? He fell down dead, didn't he?
But you didn't mean to kill him.
I told you I didn't mean to kill him. Anyway, I'm sorry. I'm sorry now that it was there.
Go ahead and cry, kid. You're just a kid. Like I was, miss.
I shouldn't have made you help me with him like I did either. I'm sorry about that, too.
Yeah, sorry. We do things we don't mean to, and we're sorry. That's the best we can do, I guess. I'm going to bed. I think you better, too.
Well, anyway, I better keep Tippy out here so she doesn't hurt me.
Would you eat a supper, okay?
Well, yeah, I guess so. Sister Love's getting.
Sister Love? How come?
Well, I had a red cream on the sideboard when I was outside. And I came in, she told me she couldn't stand the way you'd been sniffing out for it, so she gave it to me.
Tippy, come on, Tippy. Come on, boy. Let's go outside. Come on.
You act like you can't walk, JoJo. What's the matter with you?
I don't know. Except I do know one thing. Sister Love is different. She does things she means to do. And she doesn't know the meaning of the word sorry. Your Tippy's looking real bad. She's shaking all over.
But, JoJo, what's happened to him?
He's been poisoned. Seems as though all I've done since I came here is big graves. Dorcas is crying right over the grave of the dog that she had over the grave of her father. I couldn't blame her for that.
Poor Tippy. Never did anything to anybody except Bart. What did she do it for, JoJo? Why?
Well, she hated him, you know that.
I should have kept him outside like she asked.
Well, it was more than that, and I knew it. Poor Tippy. He'd just been a guinea pig. I was wondering whose grave I'd be digging next.
before I fell into one myself. Look through the brokers. There she was, just sniveling, rubbing her hand across her bony, freckled nose. Just a kid, it turns out. A scrawny, greedy kid. It was written all over that thin face, those long, grasping fingers. But I'd seen the first time I saw her that she wanted something bad. Wanted something. And she wanted everything with a ribbon around it. And what had she got? A miserable old man and a flea-bitten dog. Now both of them were dead. Was she worth saving? I thought of the advice that I'd once gotten from a hard old boy I met in a pig jail once. Nobody's any good, boy. You remember that. Nobody. I left Dorothy's standing one more and I took his grave. The rain was starting to come down because I knew that's what she wanted to do. Besides, I was in the mood to have a nice little talk with Sister Love. She was in the parlor, sitting at the back of the stone, doing outside the window. But the first time since she came here, she got away one of those plain cotton house dresses she'd had Dorcas buy for. No, she had on a flimsy lavender negligee that obviously was her own. She was playing solitaire. As soon as I came into the room, I saw that she was cheap. If you throw out the rules, what's the point of the game?
Winning? The only thing that matters.
To you?
To everybody. Except children and fools.
You know, I was always told never to trust anybody who didn't like dogs.
Really, Dorcas? Off somewhere still sniveling over that mangy little mongrel?
Tippy meant a lot to her.
Well, animals get sick and die just like people.
But why aren't you good? What are you up to?
I'm not in the mood for riddles, Jojo. I don't know what you're talking about.
All right, then I'll give you some answers. $1,000. You don't have it to pay us, and you never did. Now, so what kind of a payoff are you planning for Dorcas and me when this job is over with?
Well, you just said you had all the answers.
I got the answer to that one. A dose of whatever it was you gave that poor little heron last night, that's the payoff you're really planning for us now, isn't it?
You have an active imagination, Joe John.
That's right. That's right, I have. Oh, I can see you playing your big scene now, telling the world you barely escaped with your life. Now, you had to kill us before we killed you.
And just why, in this fancy logic of yours, would I risk murder?
For those front-page headlines you've been sweating blood for all your life. Oh, I can see them now. Evangelist kills would-be murderers. Sister Love pleads self-defense. Sister Love acquitted of murder to speak in Madison Square Garden. Sister Love survives ordeal to save the world from eternal damnation.
Joe John, I'm afraid you've missed your calling in life. You are a born journalist.
Sister Love's sarcasm couldn't screw out the fact that I had hit home. So now all the chips were on the table, and I had my choice. Stay and try to help Dorcas, or get out and save my own skin.
It was cold and dark in this house. I didn't have any light with me. I had to turn my way down the steps slowly. And all the time, I had a creepy feeling that when I got to the bottom, I was going to fall right over Paul's dead body. Of course, Paul was buried in the ground. Same as Tippy. I felt the soft damp earth of Paul's grave under my feet and I stepped back real quick.
but the bricks stayed cold and dry in the middle. And I felt my way along the wall till I found it, the loose brick, and behind it, great Aunt Nadine's beaded purse and the gold coins. My blood froze. For a minute, I thought it was my paw calling me from his grave.
You down there?
I knew it was JoJo. He was coming down the steps. JoJo knew about my money. He knew that's what I was down here for. And that's why he was coming down after me.
George? I can't see you.
I could see JoJo coming closer. Why couldn't he see me? Maybe my eyes were used to the dark. Maybe he was lying. Maybe he could see me and just wanted to catch me off guard. I couldn't trust anyone. I held the purse as tight as I could, and I reached out for anything I could find to stop him. In my free hand, found that loose brick, and I raised it up over my head, and I waited. And I waited for JoJo to take one more step.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense. If two of them are dead, I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Contact and Ford Motor Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Tesher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again, rest your eyes and listen here to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.